A recently published study has revealed what many people have been thinking for quite some time. According to researcher and urban planner Andy Yan, approximately 70% of homes purchased over the past 6 months in the city's west side were bought by people with surnames suggesting a tie to mainland China. I'm joined by David Eby over Skype. David, why did you support this survey?
Well, I've had a lot of constituents in my community come forward, and neighbors and residents, and say there's a lot of vacant housing in the community. It feels like the neighborhood's being hollowed out with vacant homes, and homes are repeatedly bought and sold, but nobody moves in, or a home's torn down, a new one's built, and nobody moves in. And so these issues were coming up again and again, and people were connecting them to international investment in the housing market. And so when I saw Andy Yan's work, I reached out to him and said, how can I help? And he said he was having trouble getting the data. He couldn't get information from the provincial government. And so he said what would be useful would be to get land titles for a defined period of sales in Vancouver. And so I helped him get the land titles he was looking for that he would have had to pay $7 for each one of them. The cost of this study alone would be about $1,000 for just a small section of time in one neighborhood in Vancouver. He's having a really difficult time with the province getting access to the information he needs.
What were you surprised by when looking at Yan's findings?
Well, I was really surprised to see a couple things. One was there was a lot of speculation about who was buying housing on the west side, in particular that there were numbered companies in order to hide people's identities, that people were showing up with large bags full of cash, and that's how the real estate deals were going down. In fact, they look quite traditional. So there's banks involved, there are mortgages involved, people are using their real names when they're purchasing the housing. What was intriguing to me was that 30% of these houses, which start at about $2 million and go to $5 million, were being purchased by students and homemakers, people with no apparent means of supporting themselves in Canada, which really gave a lot of credit to the theory about astronaut families where mom and the kids are on the west side and dad's offshore in China supporting the family. And knowing that information is helpful even just for a sense of the public policy responses to say, no, you know, it's not big faceless companies, it's families that are doing this. And so if we want to respond to this by leveraging some of the resources those families clearly have for growing BC's economy, as opposed to just showing up for school and then leaving, that's a conversation we can have now thanks to this research.
Is there a government policy you want to see applied?
Well, the issue that we're seeing is international capital. In the case of Vancouver, clearly a huge amount of it is coming from mainland China. We know from McDonald's real estate, for example, that they have an office in Shanghai. They say 70% of their luxury housing sales are coming from mainland China. It's roughly the number reflected in Mr. Yan's study. So now that we know that that's an issue and that that's having an impact on our housing market, we need to respond to that and make sure that we're getting some of the benefits of having the international super rich coming to Vancouver, and not just the detriment. And the detriment is very obviously a distortion in housing pricing in the lower mainland. So we're seeing prices going up and up for housing, totally disconnected from how much money people actually earn in the lower mainland. And the fact, the core of this study is by Mr. Yan and with my support, is to try to cobble together some data. It's not perfect data. It's got a lot of problems, in fact, but at least some data to get a sense of what's happening out there so we can make some public policy suggestions about how to respond. So I think right now we're getting a lot of the detriment that prices are going up and up. And actually, when you look at some of the census data that families are claiming income in China, they're not claiming income in Canada, which is totally legal under our current system. But is that the kind of system we should have when people are coming over to use the school system, or should they be helping us offset those costs? So we can have those kinds of conversations with data, but in the absence of it, it's just speculation and unfortunately often fueled by racism.